Amen. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, if you think it's hot here. Bear with us this morning. We've got one air conditioner. Don't seem to be working like it's supposed to. We're getting the maintenance man back down here to check it out. So bear with us. I know it's a little warm this morning, but it could be a whole lot worse, Brother Everett. It could be a whole lot worse. So we appreciate you being here this morning. We appreciate our visitors and the regulars here this morning. Down just a little bit from last week, but that's okay. It's summertime and people are busy and working and vacationing, but that's all right. We're glad you're here this morning. You is what makes church this morning. You being here is what makes us survive, makes us go, makes us grow, keeps the church doors open, keeps life in the church. So we appreciate you being here this morning. If you've got a prayer request this morning, I just want you to raise your hand toward heaven this morning. Just lift it up there toward the heavens. He knows what's going on this morning, what it's all about. If it's a sickness or disease or hurt or lost loved one, a trial of life, Brother Eugene, whatever it is, he sees our hearts, our heartaches and our needs this morning. And just raise your hand up there for just a little bit longer there. Wave it to him this morning. Let him recognize you this morning. He knows what's going on this morning, what you're in need of today. I want to ask you to take your neighbor there by the hand, if you will. Somebody there next to you. If there's somebody there next to you this morning, we begin to pray and seek God. Just ask him to bless us this morning. I'll ask Sister Glenn if she will lead us out. I'll pray together. Blessed Jesus, Master, as we come to your throne of glory and grace this morning, we love you and praise you. We thank you for this day, for truly it is a great day. This is the day you've made. We will rejoice and be glad in it, Lord. There is no other day like today. Today is the day of opportunity. Today is the day of success. Today is the day that we can be overcomers. Today is the day that we can put you first in our lives. Yesterday's gone and tomorrow may never get here, but today is the day we seize the opportunity to be what we can in you, Lord. And we ask your blessings upon us today. We ask you to bless every hand that went up this morning, oh God. You see sickness this morning, Lord. You see diseases this morning, Lord. We plead your blood today that you would touch, Lord, these maybe sick in body that are hurting, Lord. We plead the blood of Jesus. We pray you'd pour in the oil and the wine this morning, Lord. If it's a lost loved one, a wayward loved one this morning, we ask you begin to move on their hearts, Lord, and bring them back to a right relationship with you before it's too late, Lord. If it's distress this morning, Lord, if it's stress, if it's pressure of life this morning, Lord, Lord, we pray you give peace that passeth all understanding this morning, Lord. We ask you to move mountains this morning, Lord. We ask you, Lord, to level the playing field this morning, oh God. We know that you're for us. Who can be against us this morning, Jesus? Nothing will prevail against us if we have a right relationship with you, Lord, and put you first in all that we do, Lord. I pray your blessings down on this congregation. I pray your blessings down on every family, every heart that's here this morning, Lord. You'd meet every need of the hour, Lord, according to your will for us this morning, in Jesus' wonderful name today. Hallelujah. You're worthy of all praise and glory this morning. We love you this morning, Jesus. There's none other like you today, Lord. And as Peter told Jesus in the book of John, to whom shall we go, Lord? There's none other to go. Hallelujah. This morning, Lord, there's no place else to go but to the cross, Lord. We thank you, Jesus. We love you this morning, Lord. We love you today, Jesus. We love you this morning. You don't have to be quiet this morning. It's all right to say amen and get loud. It seems quiet in here. Maybe the heat's got us, I don't want to say upset, but distraught maybe, but it's all right. It's all right. It's all right this morning. If you have your Bible this morning, I want to turn to the book of Ephesians. As we turn there, we do want to say that this Tuesday, if I've got my days right, this Tuesday, the steeple will be in process to be here and putting on the building. Give yourselves a hand clap of praise this morning. We thank God. Oh, you could do better than that, like Sister Margaret said a while ago. You can give him better praise. You can give yourselves a better hand clap. There you go. So it'll be in the process of getting here, be on the way getting here, and then just the process of getting up on the building. We want to get this behind us and continue to move forward. I don't know if Sister Mandy, we didn't get with her this morning before Sunday school. Me and Brother Rob was talking this morning. We do also have another project that's out in the horizon. It's not around the corner anywhere, but we've had a piece of concrete poured out here on the back for years now. And what a great deal it would be, Sister Jane, to build a debt-free gym. Amen. Amen. A debt-free. I didn't say go in debt and be underneath the bondage of another payment. I didn't say that. I said debt-free. If we give like we know how to give and are supposed to give, and we get into fundraisers and we get excited about the program of God, excited about what a gymnasium, multi-purpose building, family activity, whatever name we want to put on it, if we get excited about what it can do for us, there's the video right there. This is not necessarily how it has to look, but a video that Brother Rob and Sister Mindy got together. What a great asset, Brother Keith, to our church. A place for people to want to get out and exercise. They're going to come out and walk in the mornings or in the afternoons. A couple of basketball goals up there for the kids to play basketball, volleyball nets inside there. How about a great place when we have a wedding like we had a few weeks ago to have a place for the reception? All these things that we can use, dinners, all these things we can use for our benefits, and we need one, amen? We need one. So again, get behind this, get excited, be excited. Be excited about it. We already have some money donated and set forth to this. So you know what? We're already getting the groundwork going. So we're already one up. Already one up on where we could be and where we desire to be. But guess what? If we all work together, being excited and doing what we can do, Sister Jenny, nothing is impossible to those that believe. Those that simply believe, nothing is impossible. The economy can be down and jobs can be scarce and the inflation can be going up and all these negative things, Brother Howard, in the natural can look bad, but you know what? God says, I got this. I was sharing with the men on Tuesday night, God owns a cattle on 1,000 hills, but he also owns the hills that the cattle are sitting on. Hello, somebody. And it doesn't matter how bad it looks in the natural. It doesn't matter if jobs are leaving. It doesn't matter if inflation is going up. God has got gold up there that we're going to walk on when we get to heaven. If he can bring some our way and help us out, guess what? We can do whatever we set our minds to if we put God first and do it for the kingdom of God. Do it for the kingdom of God. That's what we desire to do, to see God's kingdom flourish through our efforts, through what we desire him to do. Whatever we desire him to do this morning. And that's what we desire, is to be successful for the kingdom, successful in all that we do for him. Anytime I played sports or got involved in something, I never wanted to be, Brother Chuck, just half-hearted in what I was doing. I always wanted to win. I always wanted to be successful in what I do in life, in this stage of my life. Why do we not want to be the best we can for the kingdom of God? Why do we want to do things half-hearted? Why do we want to do things halfway? Why don't we do the very best we can for the kingdom of God, and let the world and let this community around us, Sister Margaret, see that, hey, you know what? Heartland Harvest is on the move. They're doing something. They're excited. And the main thing of it all this is, I want to say this, we can do all these things. And I like the excitement. I like what God is doing in our church. I believe the best is yet to come. And we're going to see God do great and mighty things through us as a group, through us as an organization. But if we ever lose sight of the Great Commission, that is souls being saved first, it's all for naught. And I'm not trying to throw water on what all I just said. But if we build the kingdom and we see these, Brother Eugene, these pews filled, all these other things we want to do will be a whole lot easier. Right. Amen. Amen. We see souls saved. Souls brings excitement. It brings new life. It brings new blood. It brings in new families. It brings excitement because they begin to tell their friends about what's going on, Sister Janie, and they begin to tell friends, and pretty soon the domino effect sets in, and guess what? Word of mouth is the greatest advertisement there is. Word of mouth is the greatest advertisement there is. If we get on fire and excited for God and he begins to bless us and we do what we're supposed to do, word of mouth will travel a whole lot faster than anything else we can do. They'll be excited about what's going on. Ephesians, that leads me to where we're going this morning. Ephesians chapter 6, and Brother Keith had shared this, touched a little bit to begin the Sunday school this morning. Very familiar thought this morning, but Ephesians chapter 6, verse 18 through 24. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 18. It says, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. And for me, that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in bonds, that therein I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. But that ye also may know my affairs and how I do, Tatius, I may not be pronounced right, a beloved brother and faithful minister, and the Lord shall make known to you all things, whom I have sent unto you for the same purpose, that you might know our affairs and that you might comfort your hearts. Peace be to the brethren and love with faith from God the Father and Lord Jesus Christ. Grace be with all them that love our Lord Jesus Christ in sincerity. Amen. And the writer here was given a very familiar, I say familiar, if you've read your Bible and read your Bible, you know these are familiar scriptures. But he gives a instruction here toward the end of his writing to the church here at Ephesus. He begins to instruct them in verse 18. He says, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. We should, as Christians, at this day and hour we're living in, encourage our friends in the body of Christ, our church family here at Heartland Harvest, to rediscover the power of prayer in our lives. To rediscover the power of prayer in our lives. Again, that goes along with Sunday school that was shared some this morning. And I didn't get this off Sunday school, but this goes hand in hand sometimes. But to rediscover the power that's in prayer. To rediscover the power that lays within us. A resource that has been laying, Brother Howard, dormant for years in a lot of people's lives, because I shared this morning opening Sunday school. Sometimes we look at prayer as the last ditch effort, when it ought to be the very first thing we turn to in our lives. It ought to be the first thing we go to, the initial thing that causes us to move, Sister Janie, and react the way we do. We ought to pray before we open our lips. We ought to pray before we get engaged in anything. We ought to pray before we begin to move our lives in certain areas. We should pray about our jobs, for our jobs, for our finances, and the list goes on and on and on and on. But we have to understand that we must utilize the most powerful weapon we have against the enemy. And the Apostle Paul says it very clearly here, praying always with all prayers and supplications in the Spirit. To encourage ourselves to pray like we've never prayed before. How many of you know we're in a war this morning? Yes. We're in a war like we've never been in before. Turn back there just a little bit. Ephesians chapter 6. Again, a very familiar scripture starting in verse 12 through 17. It says, put on the whole armor, verse 11, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Verse 12 says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand, able to withstand in the day, evil day, and having done all to stand. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. And above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith you shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. And again, that brings us to where we started. We're in a war this morning. We're in a war this morning. We're in a battle, Brother Keith, to the which we've never been before. Now, you can say, well, we've always been in a spiritual battle. Well, yeah, that's true. We've always have been. Ever since there's been a kingdom of God sitting on planet Earth, there's been an enemy to attack. Ever since you've been born, there's been an enemy after your soul. Ever since you've had children, those of you that have children, he's after your children. Those of you that are married, he's after your marriage. Those of you that work, he's after your finances. I don't care what it is this morning, he's after something you've got. And the main thing he's after is your relationship with Jesus. If he can destroy that, nothing else matters to him. You can have everything on planet Earth, but if he takes your relationship with Jesus, he's got what he's after. We're in a war this morning. We don't struggle against flesh and blood. We don't fight a natural battle like the world would like us to get entangled in, but we fight against principalities. We fight in a spiritual battle this morning against things that cannot be seen with the natural eye. We fight forces in the spiritual realm, Brother Keith, that are after us to destroy the very foundation of which we believe this morning. Our weapons are not weak this morning. Our weapons that we fight with are not weak, but they're made for battle. They are made for us to be conquerors. They're made for us to be victorious against everything the enemy throws against us this morning. Nothing should distort us, disturb us, or cause us to lose out. And the ultimate weapon is in verse 18, where we start out, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions. with all kinds of prayers. I'm just paraphrasing requests. And with this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all saints. History records. I got this. And I'm a big history nut, war fanatic, whatever you want to say. History records that on August 6, 1945, after 4 long years of war with the axis of evil, and after years of research and development, President Harry S. Truman gave order and U.S. troops on board the B-29 plane, the Enola Gay, and dropped an atomic bomb, nicknamed Little Boy, on Hiroshima, Japan. 1 minute after being dropped, the bomb exploded into a fireball with a magnitude which had never been seen before. That and the bomb dropped on Nagasaki 3 days later brought a clear and decisive end to years of death and destruction during the Second World War. Ordnance airburst bomb, it's the most powerful, conventional, again, non-nuclear, the day we're living in now, nuclear bomb ever developed. And again, it's being used now in certain areas in the Middle East. You know, we're not using nuclear weapons. But again, the challenge had come that the war had been going on long enough. Our president decided to use our resources that we'd been developing and been trying to use against our enemy. They dropped the 2 bombs on Japan. Boy, I could go political right here, but I won't do it. To stop the enemy that tried to destroy us. Sometimes in war, the situation calls for the most powerful weapon at your disposal. Yes. Amen. Amen. Let me say that again. And I'm not talking about the natural. Now I'm talking about spiritual. Sometimes, if not all the time, the situation calls for the most powerful weapon at your disposal. Amen. And this battle against the spiritual forces of evil, in the battle for the souls of men and women this morning, for our children, our loved ones, our society, our nation, our country, our world, the most powerful weapon at our disposal, sadly, is the one that's often used the least and last, and that's prayer. We talk about prayer, but we do very little engaging in battle of prayer. We talk about how bad society is, and yet we do very little about it. We talk about how warped and twisted our country has become, and we can talk about it. We can use all these quotes and famous people, but yet at the end of the day, Sister Glenna, very few people take it to God in prayer and say, God, change this situation. We talk about transgender and how it's trying to overtake the world, and homosexuality, how it's invading our rights and our morals and the very fiber on which we believe and what we believe in the Word of God. And yet we find people who can talk about it, but very few people who will say, let's find us a prayer group somewhere and go pray and seek God about this and let God change the heart of our country back to what it ought to be. We can talk about things in society. We can talk about jobs being lost in our area. We can talk about all these bad things that are going on. We can talk about all the killings and the murders that are going on in Southeast Missouri, but yet talk is cheap. If we really want our society to change, if we really want things to get better, we've got to come to a place where we quit talking about it and we quit murmuring and bickering about it, and we find some place where we come to a prayer closet again, Sister Janie, and seek God and say, God, change this situation. God, bring good out of this, Lord. Let the world and let the people know that there is a better way. And the Apostle Paul was saying here, pray always. It's going to get worse. It's going to get worse in your time. But he said, pray always, never give up. Paul calls on all Christians to pray always in every season. Though Paul saves it in the very last of the book here, I believe he doesn't do it because it's the least. I believe it's the most important weapon of our battle, of our war. It's what we engage in. It shouldn't be a last resort. It shouldn't be something we go to when all else fails. It should be the very first thing we go to, no matter what happens, on all occasions. And always keep on praying. What did he tell the church, the Thessalonian church? Pray without ceasing. Pray without ceasing. This is the foundational weapon of war this morning for the body of Christ. This is what we should hinge everything we do is in prayer, deep prayer, praying in the Spirit, seeking God's face, coming united in prayer, not letting the enemy divide us, but praying, staying motivated, staying captivated by what Jesus wants us to do, and realize that we're engaged in a battle above and beyond any that we've seen this late in history. The war is on, whether you want to accept it or not. Your children this morning are in danger. And I know that's not going to be popular this morning. Your children or grandchildren, whatever the case may be, they're in danger. Brother Ty, don't go into all this kind of... The enemy's out to do three things to you this morning. Steal, kill, and destroy. That's the three things he's after this morning. Steal, kill, and destroy. And if he can get one of those, he wants all of them. If he can get one of them, he's successful. He wants to go after everything you believe, what you hope in, what your faith is built on. We're in a war this morning that will not get easier. We're in a war this morning that there's not going to be a place we can say, I don't have to engage. When you decide you're not engaged, guess what? The enemy's got you. When you decide to quit praying, the enemy has you. When you decide that you're not going to engage anymore and be on the front line, what you've actually done, the spiritual realms, you throw up the white flag of surrender and you say, I'm giving up. It's a serious war that we're in against a serious enemy this morning. But we have a secret weapon at our disposal that he can't do anything about. And just like the special op forces, and I love military and history and war movies, but like the special op troops, if you watch some of these movies that are out, they have all these laser technology and these drones that fly around. They have sophisticated lasers that they can target from a satellite or a drone up in the sky, Brother Keith, and put that red dot or that red target on whatever they're attacking. And all of a sudden, whoever they're fighting or whatever they're going against, the target, they're out there on the ground going toward it, but help comes from above. You're not hearing where I'm going. You're not seeing where I'm going. And the target is attacked not by the troops on the ground. Yes, they're engaged in warfare, and they're trying to take the ground, but yet the help comes from above, Sister Janie, because that drone or that satellite has red dotted or put that mark on the target. And when they begin to hit all the calculations, however they do it, and they begin to put the specific locales on there, the laser-guided missiles from a fighter jet or from a satellite, whatever, destroys a specific target. You say, what are you getting at? I'm telling you, that's exactly how prayer works in the spiritual realm. Oh, yeah. Brother Chuck, we engage in battle as ground soldiers. We attack the enemy. We don't back up. Sister Kim, we go forward. And whatever we decide to pray against, whatever we decide to go against, Sister Janet, we put the spiritual target or the laser on the enemy in front of us. And guess what? Our help comes from above, from the heavenlies. And it begins to move things out of our way. And God begins to pray down all his glory and power. And that thing that stood against us now is destroying the spiritual realm. Prayer works the same way. We have targets. We need to be praying specifically for things in our lives and things that are going on in the world. Paul is calling for more specific prayers. He's calling for a lifestyle of prayer. Lifestyle of prayer. And don't get me wrong, there are times we do pray more. Somebody gets sick, we'll pray. Somebody gets injured, well, we'll pray. Something happens bad, we'll pray. But that's not a lifestyle of prayer. I'm sorry. That's not a lifestyle of prayer. If the only time you pray is when things get bad. If the only time you pray and seek God is when things are against you and things aren't going right. That's not a dedicated lifestyle. That's only praying when things get bad, when they get tough. And don't get me wrong, you need to pray in those times. But you know what? You ought to be praying in the good times too. You ought to be praying when everything goes your way, when everything's going right. Don't wait to get into a battle and pray. Pray before you get in the battles. If we do that, a lot of the battles we get into might not last as long. Amen. He's calling for a lifestyle of prayer. We pray all the time. There are times we pray in concert. There are times we pray going down the road. But what about those times we feel urged by the Spirit to go into our prayer closets and shut the door and turn the world off and engage with Jesus Christ and cry out to him and say, Lord, I need you to do this. I need you to help me here. Lord, I'm praying for this situation. I'm praying for souls to be saved. We need to have those times we get away with God and we do nothing but pray. I think we should pray together. I think we should pray always. But there ought to be times we pray when nobody else is around us, and we pray and make our lifestyle a lifestyle of prayer. Paul calls on part two of this here. I won't get time to get through all this. Paul calls on Christians to pray in the Spirit. And that's what Brother Keith was getting into some this morning. Pray in the Spirit. What does it mean to pray in the Spirit? What does it mean to pray in the Spirit? What does it mean to be engaged spiritually in prayer and seek God's face? That doesn't mean you always have to be speaking in tongues when you're praying. I'm not knocking that. Don't get me wrong when I say that, okay? We should. If we're Holy Ghost filled sometime in our lives, we're seeking God. And when God is blessing us, He ought to be manifesting our lives and come out and show Himself that He's over this temple here. But just praying to the Spirit means we allow the Spirit to talk to us while we're praying, to pray for certain issues and certain situations in our lives that we don't even know what we're praying about. Hello, somebody. He guides us and leads us and challenges us and encourages us to pray about things we don't even know what we're praying about. Listen to me, we're filled with the Spirit. Christians are to live their lives under the influence of the Spirit. This is a call for Christians to be guided and led by the Holy Spirit of God in their prayers. It's more than just saying, God, would you please give me this? Or God, I need that. Or God, would you bless me here? No, our prayer is directed specifically by the Holy Spirit. How does this work? I don't know. I'm just flesh and bones, but I know it works. I know when we pray and seek God, Sister Janie, if we're sincere and we're concerned, He'll speak to us. It might not be an audible voice, but we feel that tugging of our heart. Challenge us to pray. When we're praying and seeking God, all of a sudden he drops a name into your heart, into your head. That's the Spirit of God. You don't know what's going on in that person's life. You don't know what, but if He drops that name or that family into your life, you begin to pray. God, I don't know what's going on, but God, bless my brother, bless my sister, bless my family. I don't know what's going on this morning, Lord, but you've dropped their name into my heart, into my mind. Lord, I'm praying for them. Whatever they may be engaged in right now, Lord, you give them victory. Give them whatever it may be. We pray for people in certain situations where we don't even know why we're praying in the natural, but if we're praying, the Spirit gives us utterance and it gives us direction how to pray. In the same way, you don't have to turn there. It says this in Romans 8 and 26 and 27. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit Himself intercedes for us with groans that words cannot express. 27 says, and He who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints in accordance with God's will. If we begin to pray and seek God, and we seek His face, I want to tell you something. We won't have enough hours in daylight to pray. We'll go around all the time praying and seeking God. We'll be at work praying. We'll be going down the road thanking God or ask Him to bless or ask Him to touch. Before we go to bed at night, before we doze off at sleep, we'll be talking to Jesus. We wake up in the morning, we'll be asking Him to bless us this day and to bless our church or whatever it may be. If the Spirit intercedes for us in prayer, what we do... not know what to say, the Spirit does. When we just can't find the right words or the right things to say, the Spirit begins to speak to us and reveal to us what we should pray for, who we should pray for, what we should focus our prayers on. When souls are hurting and we don't know what to ask or what to say, the Spirit intercedes for us and gives us direction on how and who to pray for. Who are we to pray for? It says here, Christians are to pray for all saints. Christians are to pray for one another. Christians are to pray for the church. This morning is the church, Heartland Harvest, on your prayer list. Did you get up this morning and the first thing you done is say, God, save somebody this morning in our service. God, save somebody. God, bring a soul into our church that's lost and undone. That should have been the first prayer we got up this morning. Lord, you anoint this service this morning. Draw somebody. Draw somebody that needs Jesus. Draw somebody. Is the church on your prayer target? Is it on your prayer list? Do you pray regularly for your leadership of our church? Do you pray for your brothers and sisters that are part of our congregation? And Brother Keith brought this out this morning. And I might not get to it this morning for the sake of time, but He opened up his book of prayers. He has with him all the time. If anybody's around Brother Keith, you know he keeps it with him on Tuesday nights at the men's group, Wednesday nights, whenever it is. If somebody's got a prayer request, Brother Hardy goes in there. Now, thank God we got somebody that does. I'm not saying the rest of you don't pray. I'm not saying that. But I know he writes them down. And I'm sure when he goes into his prayer closet or at home, wherever he's at, I'm sure that book gets opened up. and it's prayed for. A list of prayers, a list of people we need to be praying for, a list of situations to pray for. Have you ever done this? Let God challenge you to make a prayer list and take it into your prayer closet. The church, your brothers and sisters of the Lord should be high on your prayer list this morning. We need to be in prayer over our elders and our leaders. And when I say leaders, I'm not just talking about me. I'm talking about everybody that holds a position. We need to be in prayer for our members, especially those hurting or unable to be here on a regular basis. We need to pray over the ministry of our church, what we're trying to do for God, our outreaches, all the ministries that are going on. We shouldn't take them for granted. We should never take the food pantry for granted. We should never take Sunday school for granted. We should never take any of these things we do for granted, that they're just going to be here, because there's an enemy out there in the spiritual realm that's got his hand pointed toward Harlan Harvest, saying, if I can destroy that, if I can stop this, if I can get them discouraged, if I can get them thinking about what the other one's doing and focusing on this one and that one and pointing fingers, it's going to be hard for them to go forward, to be focused. But if we get in one mind and one accord, uplift each other in prayer, seek God's face one for another, and hold each other up, and we desire God to be blessed regardless of who gets the credit for it, regardless of who's in charge, and begin to pray for all these things, guess what? God can bless. He can bless. Finally, he says here, the last part here I got here, Paul says for the church here to pray for him, to pray that he can seek God and give the words boldly and effectively to the people he goes to. He was praying that whatever he says, whatever city he goes to, wherever he has to go and share the gospel, that will be powerful and anointing, that will break the strongholds of the enemy, and we can see victory, and he can see salvations come. Listen to me. We should pray that whatever we do, Sunday school, children's church, teens, Wednesday night, I don't care what it is, we should pray, God, you give me boldness, and you give me authority in your word to share what I need to share. We need to understand that Paul's request was to encourage and to uplift, that he could boldly preach the gospel. Isn't that amazing? The greatest writer, I think the greatest writer in the New Testament, yet Sister Jane was praying for help. He never got to a place where he stood on his own two feet and said, I don't need your prayers. My relationship with Jesus just like this. I don't need nobody else to help me. No, he needed all the prayer he could get. And you sitting here this morning, you've not come to a place where you don't need any more prayer. I don't care where you're at. I don't care how established or rooted and grounded you are in church or in the Bible or your studies. You've never come to a place where you don't need any more help. You've never come to a place where you don't need any more uplifting or need anybody else to help you along the way, to help you out in certain situations. We need to be specific in our prayers. We need to be targeting certain areas of our life. How would you describe your prayer life this morning? Flourishing or floundering? I can't answer that, only you can. How would you describe your prayer life? Always or almost never? How would you describe your prayer life? Constant or erratic? Your car's going down the road out of control, rain slick road, turn sideways toward an oncoming car, out of control. What do? You pray. What do you do going down the road when the sun's out and everything's perfect? Are you praying then? The doctor comes to you in examination room with test results, and you can tell by the look in the doctor's eye everything's not good. You can tell by the news you're about to get, it's not what you wanted to hear. What do? Oh, you start praying in. But what do when you're sitting at work tomorrow morning, at your desk or at your office or factory, wherever you work at, and you're going through your everyday responsibilities? What do? Are you praying? What are you doing to the delivery room and the doctor looks at you and says, it's a boy or it's a girl, what's the first thing you do? Thank God it's healthy. Thank God it's okay. Thank God it's all right. Thank God that he's brought life into your family. But what do you do 2 o'clock in the morning when that little rascal will be Are you praying then? I tell you what you're doing. It's your turn. Some of you know what I'm talking about. You get up this time. I got to work in the morning. Are you praying then? I can answer those questions for you. That's between you and God and your prayer life. But I'm a firm believer, as your prayer life goes, so goes your relationship with God. The more you communicate with him, and the more you seek his face, and the more you're in communion with him, Brother Keith, the closer we are to him. The more he knows we need him for everything we do, Sister Margaret. But if we're erratic, and we pray every now and then, we just pray seldomly, or when the occasion rises, or when things are going bad, then what we're really saying in the spiritual realm is we don't need him all the time. And if we don't need him all the time, then how's our relationship with him? If we just call on him when things are bad, if we just call on him when things are out of hand or out of control, how's your prayer life then? I don't like to hear from my kids when things are always bad. I like to hear from when things are going good too, Sister Kim, and things are on cloud nine with them, and they talk and they just want to hang out or whatever. God's the same way. He didn't want to hear from us just because things are bad today, then we don't talk to him for a week and a half later, then things get bad again, and we show back up and start praying, and we wait a week and we start praying. You know, Jesus just didn't go to the cross and die for the bad times. He went to the cross, Brother Allen, died for us all the time. He wants to hear from us. So how's your prayer life this morning? Do you pray without ceasing? Do you pray? We're in a battle this morning. I believe, and don't have time to get into it, but it's deeper and it's more serious than we'll ever know. I believe that we're engaged in a battle this morning I believe there's laws and legislation being on the board right now, Sister Janet, just waiting to be passed. That's sitting on standby to come against us. I believe there's enemies got other things out there to attack the body of Christ and all these other things. I'm not trying to preach doom and gloom this morning, but if we're not praying and seeking God and we're not on our toes, Brother Allen, it's going to blindside us. And we're going to step back and say, how did this happen? When did I get in this situation? How did this occur in my family? How come I'm over here? How did the church get in this situation? And we're going to look back and say, you know what? We should have saw it coming. But we didn't pray. We didn't seek God. We didn't go after God with all we had. We didn't attack the enemy. We didn't go after him and take back what he stole from us. Each of us here have something to pray for this morning. Each of us here have something we can go to God for and get engaged in spiritual warfare. I'm going to ask you to stand this morning, if you will. Nobody looking around this morning, just ask you to bow your heads, if you will. And if you know you've got a battle against you this morning, I'm not trying to embarrass nobody, but if you've got a battle against you this morning, you're up against the wall, for lack of a better phrase, and you know you need God to intervene, I want you to slip your hand toward heaven this morning. God, I need some help. God, I need some help this morning. What God is going to say back to you in the spiritual realm, said, I will give you all the weapons you need. You just need to use them and trust me. You just need to use them and trust me. Trust me this morning. Begin to pray and seek God. Let him work things out in your life. Let him move mountains and obstacles that you thought would never be moved. Have faith. The Bible tells us have a little bit of faith. The faith, the grain of the size of a mustard seed, the word says, Jesus himself said, would move a mountain. Would move mountains in our lives. Thank you, Jesus. I'm going to ask you to take neighbor there by the hand and begin to pray one for another this morning. If you feel led to come to the altar and pray this morning, as we begin to pray, the altar's open. I don't want you to feel like you can't come, or if you want to come to the altar, it's open this morning if you want somebody to pray with you. But as you begin to pray, just allow God to speak to you this morning. Pray for that one you're holding hands there with. Call their name out to the Lord in prayer this morning. Blessed Jesus, Master in heaven, as we come to your throne, Lord, we just thank you that you're prayer answering God. Lord, we know, we believe in the spiritual realm. We're engaged in a battle like we've never been in before. And Lord, as we come closer to the return of your second returning, oh God, as you come to rapture us out of here and take us home to be with you forever, we know that obstacles are going to grow bigger, the fight's going to grow stronger, and Lord, we're going to have to be spiritually mature and fight the good fight of faith and stand on solid rock, Lord. And Lord, you see the things in our lives this morning, things that are hindering us, Lord, things that are maybe discouraging us this morning, Lord, and we lift up, Lord, right now your standard against the enemy, Lord. Help us to stand, Lord. And Lord, I speak to this congregation this morning, every hand that went up this morning, Lord, for every obstacle that's there, Lord, let us engage in spiritual warfare. Let us plead the blood of Jesus, Lord, and pray one for another. Lord, let's just don't be saying we're going to say a prayer, Lord, but let us pray. Let us seek your face, Lord, for our brothers and sisters. Lord, this church hangs in the balance, Lord. Our relationship with you hangs in the balance. Families hang in the balance, Lord. Our children and grandchildren may hang in the balance this morning, Lord. And Jesus, we don't want to fail you now, Lord. Lord, let us be specific in our prayers. Let us seek your face, Lord, and desire all that you have for us today, Lord. Help us, oh God, be faithful, Lord. Every hand that went up this morning, Lord, I pray for victory. Lord, I pray, Lord, for victory today. Lord, I pray you'd move this morning as only you can, Lord. Lord, we seek your face this morning for direction in our lives. We seek your face for word this morning, Lord, as we pray in the Spirit, Lord. Lord, you give us direction, Lord. Lord, you give us insight on where you want us to be and what you want us to do, Lord. Lord, let our hearts and ears be open to the heavenlies, Lord. We can hear what you're saying to us, Lord. And let us realize we need you today, Lord, more than ever, Lord. Lord, speak to your body this morning, Lord. Speak to this church, oh God, I pray, and give us direction, Lord, and give us unity, Lord, of believers, Lord, that we can see all things, Lord, come to pass that we desire for the Heartland Harvest and for this community, Lord. Let us be excited, Lord, and committed to the cause of Christ, Lord. Lord, I rebuke discouragement this morning, Lord. Lord, I rebuke discouragement this morning, Lord. Anybody here that's discouraged, Lord, I rebuke it this morning in the name of Jesus. I speak, Lord, life. Lord, I speak excitement this morning, Lord. Lord, I pray your blessings on us this morning, Lord. In Jesus' name this morning. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, if you ain't got anybody else to pray for, pray for me. Now look back at him and say, you need it. We all need it. We all need it. If you ain't got nobody else to pray for and you run out of people, pray for me. Pray for each other. Hold up your brothers and sisters in the Lord. Pray for those that aren't here. Pray for those that are away. Pray for those that are sick. Lift up each other. You know, I think we're on the verge of something great. That's all I'm going to say. I believe we're on the verge of God doing something great. New families are coming in on a regular basis. Excitement's there, and that's what we need to build on, Brother Chuck. We've got ministries that are flowing, flourishing, and as long as we stay faithful, committed, and connected, Sister Margaret, we can do all kind of things for the body of Christ. We can see souls saved, families changed. We can see healings, deliverances, all those things that the Bible talks about. I believe Brother Howard's within grasp as we continue to go forward. Let's pray for each other. Pray one for another. Where did Melissa go to? She go to the other side. I believe at 4:00, Elena, my daughter's here from Arizona. I hadn't said anything yet this morning, but my daughter's here from Arizona this morning. I appreciate her being here. I wish she wasn't that far away, but I can't help that. But I'm glad she's here this morning. And we are going to have a get-together at 4 o'clock here at the church. Is that we're here at the church at 4 o'clock. If you can be here at all possible. Be here if you can. Be here for this. If you can't, I understand. It's busy. But be here if you can at 4 o'clock. Just something we'll do for her. Like I say, she's going to be here for a couple of weeks. She's going back home. So be much in prayer for this. Anything else?